Welcome to Spa. 4 miles of pure adrenaline with a sting in the tail. Ask Jacques Villeneuve or Mika Salo. Get it wrong here, you're in big, big trouble. Michael Schumacher has local knowledge. He must extend his winning streak in Ferrari's 600th Grand Prix. Mika Hakkinen's never won here, but he's on pole again, over a second quicker than the German. And Damon Hill has a genuine podium chance after a great qualifying drive. Horrible weather for race day at Spa-Francorchamps in the Ardennes Forest. 7 points between championship leader Hakkinen and Schumacher. High stakes for the Belgian Grand Prix. You know, it's been raining here for the last 6 hours. Miserable conditions. At one stage, we were told the Grand Prix might not happen. It's still on. It's going to be a compelling spectacle. The temperature, 10 degrees. Forecasters got it 100% wrong. We were told it's going to be nice and sunny. It is now raining harder than ever. We had perfect conditions for qualifying. There was always going to be a McLaren on pole. The only question was which one. The answer came in the final seconds when Damon Hill confirmed Jordan's terrific improvement. This report comes from Louise Good.
It was all systems go for one of the most exciting qualifying sessions of the year. Hakkinen's opening shot was right on the ball and earned him provisional pole. David Coulthard may have to play second fiddle on race day, but qualifying is a different story. Coulthard wanted that pole, and for a little while he got it.
Inside the 1997 pole position time.
But Hakkinen wasn't giving up easily. It was pedal to the metal all the way for the Finn.
Let's hear the throttle through here. Not even a hint of a lift. Now, if he carries good speed into the bus stop, this could well be a 1 minute 48.
And that's exactly what it was. But before you could catch your breath, Coulthard snatched it right back. And so the story would continue all afternoon. Michael Schumacher had no answer for the McLaren's pace. Instead, his attention was focused elsewhere, on his old sparring partner Damon Hill, whose season at Jordan continues to gather pace. They were fighting hard for third. But just as Schumacher looked set to take it, a stranded Benetton brought out the yellow flags, and Michael lost his best time after he failed to back off. But if Schumacher was having a bad day, spare a thought for poor old Shinji Nakano. He got lost on the wrong side of the track. Friday shunt forgotten, Jacques Villeneuve posted a very respectable sixth place, putting a rare smile onto Frank Williams' face. In the final minute of the session, the top four drivers came out for a final showdown. Coulthard was first up, but Hakkinen was right on his tail and pulled one out of the bag.
And Hakkinen is approaching the last corner now, and over the line goes the McLaren and into pole position by 1/10 of a second. Mika Hakkinen does it again.
And Hill goes over for P3. Damon Hill, 49.7, P3. Michael Schumacher didn't improve. Damon Hill did. What a fantastic lap.
Well done, Damon. It just keeps getting better, doesn't it?
Yes, it's been getting better all the time. And this is the best result I've had with Jordan for qualifying. And I'm very, very happy.
Couldn't do a full lap because I had to slow down of yellow flags. In the last sector, when the Benetton was stopped there, it cost me couple of tens.
It was very exciting. Obviously went not the way I wanted it at the end of the session, but I took a little too much curve through the bus stop and gave away what I gained on that lap. But nonetheless, you know, second front row, it's good enough for the race.
I think fantastic. I think it was definitely a fight with me and David today, and I was lucky. I was fortunate. I got the pole.
And so the grid, Hakkinen and Coulthard, the silver arrows at the sharp end. A wonderful effort from Damon Hill in the improving Jordan. Mr. Spa, Michael Schumacher, Eddie Irvine in the second Ferrari, Villeneuve puts Williams in the top six, Fisichella, seventh for Benetton, alongside Schumacher, then Frentzen and Alesis Sauber, Wurz alongside Johnny Herbert, Barrichello sandwiched by the disappointing Prosts, Verstappen, Stewart between the arrows, Diniz and Salo, the Tyrrells, and the Minardis, and all 22 qualify for the Belgian Grand Prix. Qualifying in the dry, it's still pouring down here, and in conditions like this, especially at this circuit, you do tend to look towards Michael Schumacher, quickest in warm-up this morning. Okay then, I'm joined as always by Tony Jardine. How dangerous is this place in the wet?
Extremely dangerous. Even though this is a shortened Spa, the old Spa, it's the same. On the other side, the Ardennes there, it can be dry or it can just be damp. And in 1966, it's very relevant, Jackie Stewart had his biggest ever crash here. So on the first lap, it was raining over the other side. They're on tri tires. He went so far off the track that they didn't see where he'd gone off, and he was lying upside down in a pool of petrol. It was only that his teammate, Graham Hill, in the other BRM, saw this hole in the hedge and found him, stopped another driver and got the steering wheel off his special spanners. Very, very dangerous. Fickle weather can change all the time. The drivers must adapt themselves the whole lap.
Okay, let's just have a quick check of Michael Schumacher's record here at Spa. It really is worth a look. Look at that. Debut 91, first Grand Prix win 92, second in 93, first past the post 4, 5, 6, 7, and possibly 8 as well. Okay, now you can enjoy one of the great experiences in Formula One, a lap of this imposing circuit, just over 4 miles. It'll take you around about a minute to 50 seconds speeds, nearly 200 miles an hour. Martin Brundle is all set to talk you around, and it's Mika Häkkinen, the pole sitter, at the wheel.
The Belgian Grand Prix here in Spa-Francorchamps, 4.3 miles through the Ardennes Valleys, one of the great circuits of the world and certainly one of the driver's favourites. We're going to join Mika Häkkinen now for his qualifying lap, which in fact turned out to be pole position. 160 miles an hour down to La Source. First gear, full lock. Walk the car out to the barrier with a throttle and accelerate hard down towards Eau Rouge, building up to a speed of 180 miles an hour. You must not lift the throttle on the way in. Blend it to about 80% now and hard on again over the curbs on the inside, 185 on the top, building up speed already in top gear. It's a long, long climb up to Lecoum, 200 miles an hour. You'll feel the energy when he brakes. Now into Lecoum, down three gears and then down another, 80 miles an hour, building up through Malmedy, 90 on the apex, hard on the throttle on the exit, plenty of curb, downhill towards Rivage. Brake a little bit earlier, 60 miles an hour on the apex, get on the power early, and then the car will slide from the back. Don't brake too hard, let the car run through, it's slightly off camber, downhill now towards Pouhon, 180 miles an hour again. But just come down one gear, don't brake too hard, keep it around 150, back on the power, there's enough room, upshift, and build up once again to 180. Now you've got Fania Chicane, third gear. Now he'll take second gear in the middle, get ready to apply the power, the back's going to step out, there it is, a short straight and a tricky little right-hander, again off camber, run wide, now it's Stavolo. Up through the gearbox, does he lift? Not at all, he's rejoining the old part of the circuit and heading home. An easy right and left sweep if it's dry, but then you've got Blanchimont, 195, let's see if he lifts the throttle at all. No way, you can hear the engine dulling as he scrubs off a little bit of speed, now down five gears into the bus stop. A lot of curb on the left, sawtooth curb on the right, back will step out a bit, short shift in the middle, attack the curbs, over the line, and pole position for Mika Häkkinen.
This time they've all got to do that through the spray. This time last year, the first Grand Prix ever to be started behind the pace car. The pace car is ready and waiting once again. Rejoin us here in Spa in a couple of minutes' time. And you rejoin us at Spa-Francorchamps. Ralf Schumacher and all the other drivers facing a huge test today. It is still raining very hard indeed. Remember last year, Ralf's brother Michael, his strategy of using intermediates, not full wets, really put him in control of the race from the start. What tactics can we expect from the drivers today? Some drivers have already fallen off the Spa roller coaster in warm-up. Here's James Allen.
Michael Schumacher was fastest in this morning's wet warm-up, trying out a number of different strategy options, while David Coulthard tried out the tyre barriers. We saw last time out in Hungary how changing your strategy during a race can win it for you. And today, wet or dry, it may well be the same story. Now, the choice here at Spa is between one stop and two. The computer says that two stops is slightly faster, but of course it all depends on your track position. It can be wet 1 minute and dry the next here at Spa, so you have to have a number of different strategies available and choose the right one at the right time. Tyre choice is also critical, as there are hard and soft wet tyres available. With two cars between himself and Michael Schumacher, Mika Häkkinen can afford to opt for a conservative one-stop strategy. Michael Schumacher, on the other hand, must go for it. And judging by his pace in this morning's warm-up, he'll start the race with a full fuel load and plan to stop twice. Damon Hill could be a key player today. If Jordan gets the strategy right and he maintains his position, he could be a dark horse. But as ever, the weather will dictate everything.
Damon, what do you do with your setup on a day like today? It must be very difficult to call. Do you go wet, dry, somewhere in the middle? How do you work it out?
That's what we spend most of our time trying to work out between the warm-up and now. And, you know, you cannot predict the weather here. I mean, anyone who says they know what it's going to do next is lying. I don't believe they do. So you have to go with what you've got, and the conditions at the moment are wet, and it's drizzling enough to keep it wet for a while.
What's the car like in the wet?
It's quite good in the wet. I mean, we didn't run full wet in the warm-up, and we're still competitive, so I'm reasonably optimistic.
You're right in the thick of it today. You've got Michael Schumacher just behind you. You've got the two McLarens up in front. You could play a pivotal role, not just in the race today, but also in the championship position. How do you feel about that?
Well, I mean, I have to do my own thing and go for my own race. I don't want to interfere with anyone's championship. But you really can't go into the race thinking about what it might affect, how it might affect other people. You have to go and get the best result you can for yourself.
We're expecting great things from Damon today, Tony.
Yeah, we are, but not from his weather forecasters. They've given up on them. He said we're using seaweed now instead. That's near as you'll get. Spoke to Mike Gascoigne, the guy who's the designer who's working hard on the Jordan now. He said they want to keep the car as much as possible close to the car they used in qualifying. They're very happy with the new Goodyear wets that they've got here, but the special thing about Damon, he's very, very smooth. And I watched him on Friday. That smooth style will pay off in the wet, and the car's very reliable now, so... is hoping.
Let's hope so. Well, I'll tell you what, round this time you always feel a bit of a tightening in the stomach as we get towards the start of the race. I wonder what goes on actually inside the driver's cockpit, and no one really is better equipped to explain that than Martin Brundle.
Go! Villeneuve gets away and Schumacher gets away better. Michael Schumacher leads!
Starting technique varies from driver to driver, but have you ever tried to operate one of those lawnmowers that won't go anywhere and suddenly takes you across the lawn cartoon-like? Well, it's a bit like that, trying to start a Formula One car. The only difference is you have half the weight of a Mini and 10 times the power of a fast family saloon car.
It's a mechanical procedure, but it becomes a head game in the end. You can talk yourself in or out of a good start.
You concentrate, basically, you in your own world at that moment.
There is not really emotion. There's just... logic going through your mind, what do you have to do?
If you do about 3 or 4 bad ones, then it does become the case of being something that's quite psychological.
So at the end of the green flag formation lap, you've got to park your car precisely on your grid position. Not quite as easy as it seems. There's a lot of colour and you've got to park exactly in your slot. Then you're going to hit the neutral button on the steering wheel and you just take a bit of time, look around you, wait for the rest of the grid to form up, try to control your breathing, and now you're looking for the red lights to come on to signify the start procedure. At that point, you pull the clutch in on the paddle on the steering wheel and then select first gear. So that's what you're doing with your hands, but down there in the pedal box, there's also some work to do. Your left foot will be on the brake pedal like this, and just a little bit of throttle for 9 or 10,000 RPM. You're staring at the lights, waiting for them to go out, and as soon as they do, swap it all over and release the clutch handle.
It's just trying to limit the amount of wheel spin. You know, anyone can drop the clutch and spin the tyres, but it's a little more difficult to control the amount of clutch slip and tyre slip you get to make the ultimate start, and that's what I try and do.
It's just concentration and making sure you're doing the things you're meant to do. It's very easy just to concentrate on the lights and forget about what you're doing with the clutch and what you're doing with the throttle.
You can win a race that you might not have won if you can get a good start.
But this is what a bad start looks like from the cockpit. Mika Häkkinen having technical problems in Canada earlier this year. But this is the ultimate nightmare scenario. A stalled car on the grid, somehow everybody missing the back of that Jordan.
If you get it right, you're doing 100 miles an hour in just over 2.5 seconds. You're driving on your instincts, looking for gaps, and then you arrive at a corner like this, La Source hairpin at Spa. One of the slowest and toughest first corners in the world, just 40 miles an hour. You breathe a big sigh of relief if you get through here safely, and ahead of you, 44 laps of one of the greatest circuits in the world.
Well, if you want to know what's going to happen strategy-wise, you might as well ask the best in the business. Ross Brawn, a very difficult day.
Yes, yeah, it will be. There'll be some flexibility needed in this race because although it's we're getting a lot of rain and it's drying out, and so there'll be some calls today.
But of course, it's going to be an attacking strategy that you're going to require from where Michael is on the grid.
Yes, I mean the car was quite good this morning, so we want to keep McLaren under pressure, so we're going to attack.
Very best of luck to you, Ross. Thanks.
Ross Brawn, Ferrari, and Michael Schumacher got it absolutely right last time. They certainly put one over Mika Häkkinen and the McLaren team. This time, though, they're on pole again. Häkkinen, he's still the championship favourite. He's still the championship leader. But this man knows every nook and cranny of Spa in the wet or the dry. The Belgian Grand Prix is coming your way on ITV in a couple of minutes. Despite that umbrella, would you believe it, the rain has stopped at Spa-Francorchamps, the most challenging track on the calendar. We have three British drivers in the top five for the Belgian Grand Prix.